Hi, we good evening and welcome everybody. Today we have with us Sandeep Das, who is doing a wonderful job on sharing his learnings in the cloud and DevOps on LinkedIn and YouTube. Hi, Sandeep, we are really excited to have you here.
Yeah, thank you. I'm also very excited to join this all the session and talk with you.
Sandeep, do you want to start with an introduction of yours? What has been your journey until now? And where do you see your journey going forward?
Definitely. Actually, to start with, I started as a normal front-end guy. So doing some UI designing, like PhDs and all. Then mm-hmm. I heard that, okay, the future will be even better and you will get more opportunities if you start the development. So I started with some PHP backend API development. Then slowly I learned about more technologies. Then come the full stack part. So I learned about full stack development using front-end like, you know, Angular, React, and all that. In the backend, it's of course Node.js. So JavaScript full stack development. Then what happens? See, I develop application. Okay, I need to host it somewhere, right? That's when it comes to the cloud part. And what happened? I work for a lot of clients, and they ask me, Sandeep, you have developed a terrific application. Now, do you know how to host it? I say, I know how to develop, but I don't know how to host. And that's the comes the part of the requirement, the hosting part, and hosting it well to, you know, accumulate, handle all the active users and handling at scale. That's when I need to find the need that I need to learn DevOps, because otherwise, see, if I work on the cloud and all, all this money will come to me as a developer, right? But if it's, I'm not working on it, someone else getting it. So that's how, you know, more in professional side, as well as the personal, go to the option, I go for the cloud. After the cloud happening, I learn the cloud, I know how to host the application, but how to do it all automatically? There should be no manual touch up. There should be, like, if I'm making an application, I should not go and update the application code in 1,000 servers. That's not humanly possible. You have to learn about the deployment strategies. You have to learn about, you know, getting the monitoring and getting all the feedbacks from the users. All should be automatic way. Then come to the part of DevOps. So that's how I started from a normal mediocre front-end engineer, like not a front-end, I would say UI engineer, to a senior cloud solution architect plus DevOps engineer. So that's my journey from starting to at the moment. And in the future, I am going for the polyglot programming. Like, you know, I already know JavaScript, Node.js, PHP. Now I learned and I'm making courses on Python, Go. So that's how it's going. And sharing the knowledge with the world.
Awesome. That's great to hear. So basically you have started as a front-end developer. Yes. Then you expanded your career out to full stack. And then now you are working with cloud and DevOps. So
exactly.
That's kind of the entire ambit, right, today, of some of the most popular things in the technology world today. So let's dig deeper, right? So let's go one step deeper. So when you start learning something, like you are talking about a lot of different things in here.
Yes.
When you start learning, where do you begin? How do you how do you start?
So starting point is like, okay, suppose I'm learning about cloud, okay? So to learn, just an example, okay? It could be something else for other technologies. Let's just say we're learning cloud. You have to find out what exactly is a cloud, because if you don't know about the subject itself, you cannot do anything. So learn about what it is. Then see what are the players in the field, okay? So in the cloud, say in the cloud right now, AWS, Azure, and you know, GCP are the top leaders. Now find out where is the trend, where which technology or which you know, cloud the most people are utilizing. Then you set a target, then search about, is there any free resources? Like, you know, or YouTube channel, like YouTube channel gives a lot of such courses and technologies, information to users. So I found the free resources first. Then if I hit hard somewhere, or maybe I'm not finding solution, maybe some paid courses, or even before going through all that, I'll start for the articles, because articles hold a huge information. People actually is underrated, but if you face any problem, instead of going to any person or anywhere directly, if you Google it and read any article that's referencing, giving a solution, maybe hint about the solution, that's even better. So that's how I learn. I start from free sources, then from articles. If not getting the answer properly, I need more help, I go for the paid courses. If that also not helping out, I just directly reach out to people who actually have the more knowledge in the subject. So that's how I start from nothing to more experience in the later course.
Okay, awesome. That's cool. Right. So what you're talking about is getting started with exploring a few free tutorials, getting started with a little bit of hands-on. And then probably if you have more things to learn. You would go for a paid course or something of that kind. And then,
just give you an example. Like I started, I faced issues. Like when I worked in my company and I was working something, I got deployment issues, okay? And at that time, I reach out to people, like, help me. If you reach out normally, one or two respond. So one respondent, they give the code and all, and then they give the solution. Similarly, when I become senior engineer and with all this knowledge, now people reaching out to me, like, give the solution, right? So this is how the life cycle works. You learn, okay. Experience, you teach others. That's how it works.
Okay. Now that you mentioned about teaching others, right? So one of the important parts that I see while I saw some of the stuff that you have done on LinkedIn, on YouTube, is the sharing part, right? Learning is one part and sharing it to others is another part. So what made you start sharing your knowledge with others? Like, how is it that you got started and where do you see your journey go further?
That's awesome to share, actually. So when I started learning, that's the question. I started learning from other people's content, isn't it? Other people's videos. So, and I am actually very grateful to those people. Even I reach out to some people, they helped me out at that phase of my life. When I was learning, I was in the learning mode. And I decided that moment, if I become senior engineer in later world, I will become the same thing. I will become the same person, a similar person who share their knowledge. So it's a cycle. I learn from people, I learn from kind people. They help me learning. And I learn a lot of things. Now I'm working a lot of companies and it's the right thing to share with the community because I got so much thing from community and it will be the proper thing to share with the same community. That's how you prepare the next generation of talents, right? Some people help me become someone great and they just not their responsibility. They're willing to do that, right? So it is kind of our things to also prepare the next generation. Like they did for me, it should be the same thing for us.
Awesome. That's cool. So right now, if I see the platforms you are active on are LinkedIn and YouTube, right? So how did you choose these? Are you exploring any other platforms? Do you want to explain a few things about that?
Sure, definitely. Actually, even when the Facebook, or say Facebook is not the learning part, but when Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube all came, it's all new to us. Like we are, that time growing up and all, we were seeing a lot of things coming. So I was exploring all the options, to be honest, not just these two or three, I was all the options and saw people are, so you have to see where the people are going forward, where the majority going forward. I see majority of professional, high talented professional going to LinkedIn, sharing their knowledge, sharing information, communicating with other professional. That's how I figured, like, okay, LinkedIn is the right place for professionals. Then whenever I face issues, I go to YouTube and search for the solution. At the beginning, it was not much, but still helpful for others. Now, if you just open YouTube and search for any topic, you see a lot of videos, and excellent videos. Now, that became possible because people find it useful. Now, they keep using it, and they thought, why not? Let's start by ourselves. And they also started. That's how it became big. So people, where the people goes, that's you have to select. If it's a social platform or any professional platform, if no one is using, there's no point using it. Because you just not supposed to talk with yourself. You have to talk with other people. So make more network, make more connections. So that's why you have to see where the people are going. If they're going to LinkedIn, go to LinkedIn. Suppose next day they're abandoning LinkedIn and going somewhere, definitely I will also go into that platform. So that's how it works. You have to see where are the people. There is the network lies and you have to attach to the network to get knowledge and share the knowledge at the same time.
Awesome. Okay, cool. So where do you see... what kind of content are you creating right now? And what kind of content do you plan to create in future?
So at the moment, I already done with the cloud, mainly focus on the AWS because from last 6 to 7 years, I'm working actively on the AWS solution for different companies around the world. So that's why that is my expertise part. So I made a lot of videos on that. And I'm also expertise on DevOps. So I made two things. One is the DevOps with AWS. So all the tools that in AWS we can utilize for the DevOps related things that I've made the series is already available on my YouTube channel. And after that, I started teaching about the DevOps tools like Jenkins, Terraform, Ansible, and SigiDoops, GitHub Actions, these kind of tools, which we today use in our DevOps job. So that's what I'm right now doing. And in the future, I'm developing a course for the Python with SDK, Cloud SDKs, and Go with Cloud SDKs. That's the future plan at the moment.
Awesome, awesome. That's perfect. So you're talking about a lot of different DevOps tools, right? So whenever somebody hears DevOps, they are scared because people put a lot of tools under the ambit of DevOps, right? Docker, Kubernetes, Terraform, Ansible, Azure DevOps. Like you can list another 100 set of tools.
Yeah, all are great.
Right?
Yeah.
So where do you see, I mean, what are you seeing? What are the most important things that you think somebody starting off in their career, like let's say somebody wants to become a DevOps engineer, right? So what are the few things, I mean, you don't want to start with a list of 100 tools, yeah. right? So that would be too difficult to learn. You'd want to start with probably one or two things and slowly expand on top of that, right? So what would that journey would look like if you were designing that journey?
Yeah, so first thing, I mean, you learn other things, not doesn't matter. Learn Linux and sales scripting. If you don't know these two, you cannot succeed in this field because everywhere you look, you are running sales scripting. Be in the deployment script, be in the automation, be in anywhere. You are utilizing sales scripting. And mostly 99% case you're running on the Linux machine. I did 99% job in Linux only. Okay. Now Linux a lot of type, Red Hat and this and that. I'll not put there, but think it's a Unix or Linux system that you have to work on. So Linux and sales scripting, if you master that, that's the starting point. After that, you will see what you're working on. In most cases, I will say even 99% cases, you will be working with codes. So if you understand how the code flow works, how the logic works in the codes, that will help you develop a solution for deployment or the build and all this. I will come into that phase a bit later. But let's say programming knowledge basics, you must know how to how you can do it. Learn any any programming language, be it not just any. I will say because right now you have to think about trend. What trend is going on? Either Python, either Go, or either JavaScript. These three are most popular languages at the moment. And if you're planning to go with the DevOps, then you should learn any of the one language. If you ask me which one you should go for, I will say either Go or Python based on your learnability or suitability. What you can prefer. Go on that. So that's the programming part. Now, what you're going to do with code? You are going to deploy it somewhere, right? Maybe in some internal application, maybe it's a public-facing application, whatever may be the case. You are running multiple instances. So you have to think about how I can deploy my one version of code or two or three, whatever the version of code you have, to that those many instances. You need deployment tools, okay? But before even that, if you're going to deployment, you have to make sure you make ready the code deployable. So that is a CI/CD part. CI in the phase you run your you get your code from the source, maybe GitHub, maybe Bitbucket, maybe any source, so code commit, whatever it is. Get the code, then you have to make a runnable or deployable code. That's the CI phase. You get that and make sure before even deploying, you have to run test. So you have to have a way, or you should know how to test the application codes before moving to the production or staging anywhere.
Right.
You have the runnable code. That's the build part. And there are a lot of build tools. Now the point that you say the tools are a lot of there, right? So think about what is the most efficient tool for the case. Sometime, if you have budgetary constraint, then you may go for a self-hosted solution in Jenkins or maybe GitHub Actions Self-Runner. That you can do. If you have good budget, then you can host this kind of open source solution in an AWS or Azure or GCP, and then you can save cost. If you have a lot of more budget or maybe credits from the provider of the service, say you have credits from AWS or your company have a good budget with AWS, then use the AWS tools that will help you to make sure all the costs in single place. So based on your requirement, based on your budget, and based on the team skills also, because team don't know how to use Action or Jenkins or AWS solution, how they're going to make the solution. So see what teams, in the team, what they're capable of. So based on a lot of things, you decide what tool you should be utilized. Okay, you should be utilizing. Now, based on that, you select your tool. Again, you don't have to learn 100 tools. You have to select what tool should be used for your application, learn that. That way, in the future, if some other tool, you'll learn it. Go that way. You don't have to learn 100. You have to learn based on the needs. But the rule of thumb, learn with the open source first. So I will say learn with Jenkins or GitHub Actions. Those will be better. Okay. So that's the part of the build part. Now, build happen. Now the deployment. So in the deployment, again, you need, there are a lot of good tools. go for the open source, learn the open source first, because that's probably what most of people will be utilizing. That's not proprietary, that's open to everyone. So everyone will try to adopt that first. Okay, so learn Jenkins, then you see what the company is utilizing. Maybe they're utilizing AWS, then use the code commit part, because any code commit for the storage, then use the code build for the build part, like making it deployable code, and then use their tool for deployment. So the deployment part, again, there are a lot of tools. The open source one is Jenkins, is most famous, both for CI and CD. If it's AWS, use the code deploy. If it's in you are going for the repo based kind of thing, so GitHub have their GitHub Actions, which can be utilized for the deployment. So see, what I'm saying here is that based on your need, budget, you should go for the build tool as well as the deployment. So that is one. I'm not learning 100 tools. I'm learning what I need. That's the flow. So done with the build and deployment. Now come to the monitoring part. So you are deploying solution, you're managing solution, you have to have observability over the solution, like monitoring. Now again, there are open source and proprietary. Open source, which most people will try to adopt first. Proprietary, maybe the cloud solution provider is giving you. So in the open source part, learn Prometheus and Grafana for the monitoring, or maybe NGOs, that also good. And in the proprietary part, maybe for example, you're running in AWS, so use the CloudWatch just for the monitoring of the resources. So based on the need, you have to learn. People don't know how to start. I just already told. Learn, start with the open source solution first, which already people are adapted. Then look at if the cloud solution provider giving better solution, cost efficient solution, why not go for the cloud provider? Because they're giving a cost. Cool. But yeah, locking part, I should remember, if it's the locking, it's everything. If you're going for the proprietary solution, it's locking. That's the important.
Yeah. I think there are a lot of things that you touched upon, right? Yeah. Starting with continuous integration, continuous deployment, infrastructure as code. And also, let's probably pick up one thing at a time and let's get started, right? So as far as continuous integration and continuous deployment are concerned, you were saying probably we can get started with Jenkins. Or if you are in a specific cloud, you can make use of the cloud specific tool. You were talking about AWS, you have code deploy or code build.
Yeah, code commit, like code that. Deploy, code build. So based on the need is that. Okay.
Exactly. If similar tools exist on Azure and Google Cloud as well.
Exactly.
So did you get a chance to explore Azure DevOps? Because one of the things I saw in my experience was running Jenkins, setting up Jenkins and running it in your infrastructure in a very reliable way is a challenge also.
It's a big challenge.
And that's where I saw that Azure DevOps was really, really good. Even if you actually are building applications, let's say in AWS or Google Cloud, Azure DevOps can connect and deploy to your resources which are present in other clouds as well, right? So how was your experience with Azure DevOps?
So Azure is also good. I mean, see, all clouds have tools, just naming is different in other tools. Think about that. Like Azure have their Azure DevOps and they have their pipelines, repos, all that. And similarly, all cloud have it. Think about, is the budget part, is the matching or not? Because there could be a number of solution. If the budget is not matching, no point. Azure DevOps, excellent. I hosted around, say, two projects using the all the deployment and the build, everything, whether it was still working perfectly fine. No problem, no downtime, nothing. So again, because I have provisioned all the resources properly. So the provision also have invested in the budget, right? If you all that, then it will be all good.
Yeah, let's probably also talk a little bit on infrastructure as code, right? So you're talking about Terraform, Ansible, things like that. So how did you, what's your experience with that?
Okay, so actually you have to think about first that why we need infrastructure as a code. Okay, what happened, one client, I deployed their CI/CD, their all the computes, everything, okay? I did in the US West region, one US region, okay? After delivering the solution, he asked me, no, I don't want in the US region, move it to India. I was like scratching my head. I walk all that with 1 or 2 months work. How I can do that in the next one day? I search for a solution, I find out, if I had used the infrastructure as a code, it would have been a matter of a second. And that opened my eyes. It's like erasable and rebuildable or deployable anywhere as you want with a fraction of second or minutes. That's was eye opener, and that's a reproducible. can destroy, you Absolutely. Can develop for staging, production, everything. And if you don't need it, remove it. Like snap.
Exactly.
That was the need. Need to be more portable in the cloud. You cannot be in one region locked. You cannot have a one ability zone locked. You have to be a global thinker.
If you are working with enterprises, you are talking about multiple environments, right? It's not just multiple regions. You have multiple environments. Right.
Staging, so it's test, like, production.
Exactly. So you
we don't want to create manually everything.
Exactly. And it becomes even more important as we move towards the cloud. Because you would want to provision infrastructure on demand and release it back when you don't want it. You don't want to keep it running all the time.
Exactly. I mean, see, the test people, they will come to office. They maybe say 10, then leaving 6. What is the point running it all the 24/7? You are making huge bill just for the test team. Why? Like have a cron job set and start the cron job at the morning before they come to office, say 5 or 10 minutes early. When they're gone, say 6 or 6:30, you destroy everything. That's it.
Yep.
Only keep the data on the reports. Yep. That's what is needed. Nothing is needed, right? So that's how it should be.
Exactly. Yep.
That's now I think I talk about that.
I mean, needed you...
Sorry, go on.
Okay, let's get to the tools, right? Infrastructure as code tools. How was your experience with Ansible and Terraform, and how do you see the difference between them? And what would be the use cases where each one of them will be right fit?
Right. So first thing, that what is a Terraform? Terraform is the infrastructure code tool, and you have multiple cloud with that. Okay, you can deploy like resources in AWS, Azure, GCP. Even there are a lot of other like Alibaba Cloud, a lot of providers. So you have to think about all this concept before doing that. Once you're done with that, you can deploy resources to anywhere, and you can delete whenever you need it. You can update as you need. Okay, but Ansible is not that. Ansible is configuration management tool. Okay, of course it's kind of infrastructure or like infrastructure as a code tool, but it's completely not. It's help you achieve that, but it will not do on behalf of you. Terraform do it. Terraform on behalf of you will create the resources, manage the resources. Ansible help you like patching the system, like running some cell scripting in a mass level of like mass number of computer systems, all do that. But it's not help you like manageable deployment. It cannot be like it doesn't store.
So you're talking about. So basically what you're saying is that infrastructure as code is of two different parts. One is infrastructure provisioning. The other one is configuration management. And Terraform is an infrastructure provisioning tool. And Ansible is a configuration management. Provisioning is basically I would want to create a new VM. I can go for Terraform. If I would want to install specific software, or if I would want to install an OS patch or something like that, then probably that's where I would use Ansible.
So that's how it is. The difference people don't know, they say they both fall in the same category. First one is infrastructure code, second one is a configuration code. And there are other tools, policy as code, environment as code, a lot of things are there. Now, just to say the audience that they are watching, it's not just Ansible. There are a lot of other solutions as well, similar to Ansible. Again, the same thing for Terraform also. Like Terraform, there are a lot of other solutions. Now, Terraform part is very important, because that what will be most people will be working on as a host engineer. So just like Terraform, there is Pulumi, there is Cloud, is like the CDK. Similar kind of tools are there. So you should see what are the top tools. Don't learn everything, just the top two or three, because those where the opportunity lies. So you have to be careful then.
Right. I think over a period of time, I would see CDK and Pulumi getting really, really popular.
Exactly.
Terraform is really popular now. I think Pulumi and CDK would get popular going forward. So probably if somebody's starting now, probably Pulumi or CDK might be a great place to start. Terraform, I would say, is great to start.
Terraform, good. See, if you seek the production level deployment at this moment with the stability in mind, I also go with the Terraform. If you're thinking about experimenting some product, say, or your team all know about coding, all are developer people, then go with Pulumi. Because one of the major difference I will see, if it's not a development team and they want to implement infrastructure as a code, say system admins, or just say DevOps engineer, then go for the Terraform. If your team is like full of excellent developers who know programming knowledge and all, they have the experience, then go for Pulumi or CDK. Otherwise, you cannot manage all these kind of solutions.
Right? Exactly. So if you would want to do infrastructure as code with a program, then Pulumi.
Exactly. Programming.
If you would want to do, like, I think Pulumi supports a number of programming languages. Right?
Yeah, Java, so it's support Node, JavaScript, TypeScript, Node, exactly. Python, Go, major ones.
Yeah. However, if you would want, if you have more of non-programming folks, maybe administration folks,
yeah,
who are more comfortable with some kind of scripting kind of language, like, for example, HashiCorp control language is what is used with Terraform, yeah, then probably Terraform would be the
They should go with the Terraform, right. Less programming knowledge, like, close your eyes, go with the Terraform, that you can say.
Okay, okay, awesome. Yeah, and that's where we have things like CloudFormation, like each of the clouds also are offering, but those scripts would be very, very difficult to maintain, and that's why we don't really recommend them.
I'll just share one experience with me. I tried with, like, one solution I had in mind. It's complex one, okay? It's not easy, complex one. I tried to deploy with the CloudFormation. Even on AWS, I'm telling you, I didn't like it. I see the complexity. I try to explain to the team. Team, like, they're confused. They already, like, there's a failure. Like, they don't want to continue with the CloudFormation. And same thing I did via the Terraform. I was like, oh, it's very easy. So the easiness to use was more in the Terraform. So that's one of the reasons.
Exactly. So, I mean, if you are creating resources, there are a lot of things that you would want to define in a CloudFormation script. And I mean, you might do it once, twice, but you cannot maintain it over a long period of time. And that's where Terraform really, really helps.
Right. And so another important part will be the multi-cloud part. So if you learn Terraform, okay, or Pulumi or whatever the tools, it's multi-cloud. But if you're going with a proprietary, it's only to that cloud. So you should start with something that has multi-cloud reach.
Exactly. I think we need to add a disclaimer there as well. By multi-cloud, we don't mean you write a Terraform script for AWS. You can directly run it in Azure. That's not the case.
But
Terraform can deploy to multiple clouds. That's what I guess you are saying, right?
Yeah. Even suppose, say, you have one Terraform project that handle two cloud, is possible. But it's not the case for the CloudFormation. You can only deploy to AWS, nothing else.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. So that's good, right? So another area which is very, very popular when it comes to DevOps today is containers and container orchestration, right? So Docker, Kubernetes, and it also helps you to standardize a lot of stuff. Earlier, you were talking about scripting, learning a lot of Linux scripting and things like that, right? What I found in my experience was once we start making use of containers, container orchestration, the need for scripting is mostly eliminated. So one of the things I also like recommend to a lot of early learners is get started with programming, jump into containers and container orchestration, and then see how to do that in the cloud. So that's another journey path that I kind of recommend. Like, in addition to the earlier path that you recommended, this is one more. So how do you see
let me start with that, because container are one of the most short after skills in DevOps or in the programming also. It's one of the requirement to join as a software developer, programmer, of course, in DevOps. This thing revolutionized the entire microservices architecture-based development. Previously, what has happened?
Right.
All things in a single thing, like single instance have all the resources. And we are making copy of the entire instance. Now it changed. One particular service have their own container and particular developer working that particular API or say service. And multiple developers working multiple containers. That enabled them for the rapid deployment, integration, and all that, right?
Right.
Absolutely. This kind of flexibility only you can get with the container. And not just that. I don't need to understand if you're running a programming, like you develop application in Java. I don't have any knowledge in Java. I'm a DevOps engineer. I have to deploy application. I don't need to know about your programming, what programming you have.
Yeah, you don't really need to worry about what's in the container.
Exactly. Yeah, just give me the image and I will just make a build of it. And then I will just deploy to, say, Kubernetes as orchestrator or maybe ECS, EKS, anywhere. As you need. I just need the image. An image definition, maybe storing the any image repository. So anyone thinking about like utilizing a Docker image or any kind of image, you have to think about it has to host get hosted somewhere. Maybe Docker Hub, maybe Amazon ECR, maybe say GCP, their repository. So it has to get stored in this repository. Then you can utilize that repository source to deployment in say Kubernetes or say EKS, AKS, anywhere. So that's the important part here. So one part is here as a DevOps engineer. Okay, now think about like talk about what does a DevOps engineer have to do? As soon as the code getting pushed, we have to make a build out of that code, right? So in the build phase, what you should be doing, make a generate a new version of the Docker image. That's as a DevOps engineer, you have to do. That's what
right. Right. So when you are making use of a container, what you would do as part of your continuous integration is to build a Docker image. Exactly. And as part of your continuous deployment, you would deploy the Docker image probably to Kubernetes or wherever you would want to deploy it. That's awesome. Okay, cool. So container orchestration would also be something which somebody who's starting off can consider to learn, right? So that's what we are talking about. Awesome. Sandeep, the other part where a lot of people want to get started with is the cloud, right? So let's say some beginner wants to start with AWS. I see that AWS is one of the areas of your expertise, right? So, how do you recommend a beginner to get started with the cloud? Let's say I have a program, I'm a programmer, I have a little bit of experience with programming, and now I would want to start with cloud. Where can I start?
So you have to, anyone want to learn cloud specific to AWS, you have to think about what are the core services. So if you go to any cloud provider, they have listing of the resources, and they have learning resources as well. They will say, what are the core services? What are the mediary services? What are the advanced services? You have to think about what are the core services that you have to use anyway. Start from there. Say AWS, you have to learn with AWS. EC2, you have to learn IAM, so authentication part. You have to learn about how to utilize the keys in the IAM keys, security and the key and the security secret, those things. Then you think, what are the other tools? Okay, just the compute part, EC2. Then think about the database part. Say you have to learn about RDS. So what in the RDS, you can run MySQL, PostgreSQL, Oracle. So you have to think, you have to understand what are the services are there. One by one, learn about that. What are the solution or the support we can, solution you can develop on the services? Because what are the tools or services? We have to finally make a solution out of that. You cannot simply make solution with using EC2. You have to utilize EC2 with S3 or EC2 with RDS or maybe CloudWatch or maybe multiple services at once. You have to be a solution architect mind or solution towards mind that ultimately my end goal is to make solution out of it. So what are the tools required to generate the solution? Learn from the core services, you will get a knowledge. Then other services like advanced services based on the need. So what happened when I learned, I didn't learn all the AWS services because that's not humanly possible. There are a lot of services, machine learning, control tower, a lot of other things, right? But how I started, I wanted to run an application in the cloud, AWS to be named. How to do it? I need to, the application, what I need? I need to install the code in the instance. To do that, I have to first SSH into the instance that I need the client, my MacBook, SSL, see Windows have PowerShell, Linux have the terminal. Just use that and then log in into the machine. The code, everything will be given by the EC2 UI console. Log into that, install the Git, pull the changes in the that particular instance, then install all the requirements, right? Then we have the application code ready, but it's not runnable. Because what? Application need to deal with the data. So then learn about the RDS, because RDS, you can host the database solution. Maybe it's a relational database management. So then an RDS, if it's a NoSQL, then what? Then use a DynamoDB or maybe DocumentDB. Based on the need, you have to see what service or tools we're supposed to use, then integrate it. That's how I learn. And that's how I can map between the services and easy to learn also.
Okay. So what you're talking about is get an overview of the services. Try and figure out what would be the best services for your specific solution. If you'd want to deploy a simple application talking to a database, probably you would use EC2 and probably you'd probably use RDS. If you don't want to if you don't want to really make it complex, probably you can start with Elastic Beanstalk would be much more easier. Then you don't really need to talk to an EC2 or something of that kind. So start with deploying an application first. Get a feel for it, and then try the different services.
And my first application was a Hello World. Next other programmer, I started with a Hello World. I had one HTML, the Hello World. As a first learning part, I installed in Apache or maybe Nginx server, and then I just hosted Hello World. That was a happiness I got when I first deployed anything. From there, hosting solution, then getting user a million. So that's how you start, small.
Yeah, and do you see any role for certifications in here, right? One of the biggest challenges with the cloud is that there are too many services. As you were saying earlier, like I might learn five to deploy an application. Probably I make use of 10 services, and yes. I have like AWS, for example, offers more than 200 services, right? So it's impossible exactly. to be a master of all that. Yes. And like that's where I thought certifications can play a good role, at least to get a big picture. Not, I mean, you cannot obviously learn everything yeah. in depth, but to get a big picture of all the services, certifications might play a role. So do you have any opinion about that?
Yeah, I think I will start with, I myself certified 6 certifications with AWS and 1 with okay. GCP. So 2 okay. professional with AWS and 4 are associate, just so I can learn about all the challenges this certification solving, what kind of thing you learn. I had a curiosity. So if you right. have curiosity about cloud, you want to learn more about the cloud, one of the very good example or way I would say is the with certification, because certification is covering a lot of services, a lot of scenarios, will help you learning the cloud.
All right.
Sometimes even more than that, if you see in the more job description or job requirement these days, is starting with minimum 1 certification with AWS. Some if it's right. a senior role, then with the AWS professional certification. If it's the junior or intermediate role, there is they are seeking the associate. So that's become a right. norm at these days. You should have
exactly.
1 certification to get the good opportunities. And of course, learning part also.
Absolutely. I think that's awesome. That's great. So I think we touched upon the most important parts that we wanted to talk about, Sandeep, right? Cloud and DevOps. You have any like anything that you'd want to talk about, like anything that you'd want to say to the audience?
Yeah, audience, I would say that, see, there are a lot of technologies, there are a lot of people, a lot of saying a lot of things. It's very easy to get confused. How to not get confused? That's the important part here. First, don't listen to all what are saying. Set a goal, set a 1% goal. If you listen to 100 people and do nothing, get confused, then you will not make progress. What I did right. in initial stages, I follow one author, their entire course, then I implement a solution, then I, okay, understood, I tried that, let's try out different thing. But not like 100 people, if you try 100 things, 100 solution, no output will be there. Focus,
right.
then discipline. Yeah. Because without these two, you cannot make progress. Because see, it's 7 to 8 year journey from when I started knowing nothing into all this cloud and then becoming, it doesn't become overnight, not in a month or year. It took me this right. many years. So it will take time. It will take a lot of, you know, mental, you know, strain. Because if you're thinking about certification and all, just get prepared for it. You need a lot of focus, a lot of learning. Then okay. in the examination, like right now, maybe in the front of computer in your home, but still it's a tension. You should make yourself knowledgeable to handle the tension. Otherwise, you get frustrated. So that's yeah. important.
Learn okay. single so what you're talking about. So what you're talking focus. About is the focus is the most important exactly. thing, right? So identify what you want to learn.
Yeah, and not just that. You know, it's very easy to get distracted these days. Netflix, Amazon Prime, absolutely. A lot of things are there. So sacrifice yeah. something to get something. That's important.
Yeah, right. So focusing on, like, I think focus on 2 different parts, right? One is make sure that you know what you would want to do next. Yeah. The next step, what you want to take, you should be clear about it. And you should focus just on that. You don't want yourself to think about a lot of things and try to learn yeah. 10 things at a time.
I will give you one example, okay? One guy reached out to me, say, Sandeep, I want to become a cloud architect, okay? I said, good. I give him resources. The next day, he came to me and said, Sandeep, I want to become DevOps engineer because you are sharing posts right. about, you are sharing videos. I said, what? I mean, you have to think about simple. I didn't become DevOps engineer and solution architect single day. I started with the cloud solution, you know, architect and solution implementation. Then I found out, I need to learn DevOps to get some opportunity in DevOps. I learned because, but you cannot do all this single time. You don't have exactly. even a development background. So I counter question, yeah. Say, do you know yeah, programming? So no, that was the thing.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's one of the major challenges, right? So people, I think that's common across most of the industries, and it's very, very high in the IT industry. It's that we would want to chase the next new technology, right?
Exactly.
I heard a buzzword somewhere, I want to chase it and learn. It's good. I mean, that's how you learn. Definitely, that's a exactly. very, very good
curiosity
thing.
Is good.
As humans, you should have curiosity. But the thing is, human brain does not work that way. You can't keep running after the latest trend and have success, yeah. right? So most of the times, success is built on layer by layer. So you
exactly.
get programming first, Then you deploy your first application, exactly. You build your first application, probably deploy it to the cloud, then probably expand further. So it's more step by step, and you need a lot of focus, right? You can't try and do 100 things at a time. You have to decide what you want to do next and focus on it. And one of the important things I think about the IT field in general is the fact that if you are really good, like if I'm a really, really good programmer, if I'm in the top 5% of the programmers, even if I don't know DevOps, probably there will be good opportunities for me. If you are really, really good in the top 5% of anything, like whether it's DevOps, whether it's machine learning, whether it's AI, whether it's the cloud, especially any of the clouds, AWS, Azure, or Google Cloud. If you are in the top 5%, if you are really, really good at it, there are opportunities out there. You don't need to learn 100 things, but you need to learn 5 or 10 things very, very well.
See, there are two things, two kind of person, generalist and specialist. You see the market, they pay more for the specialist. Why? Because they're specialist. Simple as that.
I think it's there needs to be a balance, right? So I need to have a big picture overview, but I need to specialize in a lot of things as well. Right? You can't specialize in 100 things, but you can have a big picture overview.
Yeah, and so you think don't about really. Having growth mindset is important because at the time when I was a PHP developer, PHP was on top. Then PHP become loose because a lot of people doing PHP.
It is good.
I have to learn JavaScript that way. So you see what is in trend, become expert on that. That's how you can have the proper growth.
It was awesome talking to you, Sandeep. Thanks a lot for taking the time to be here. Thank you. Thank you for being here.
Awesome session. Yeah. Thank you.